to a breakthrough. In 1980, he created an equation of his own, one that combined all of the Julia sets into a single image. When Mandelbrot iterated his equation, he got his own set of numbers. Graphed on a computer, it was a kind of roadmap of all the Julia sets, and quickly became famous as the emblem of fractal geometry. The Mandelbrot set.
It's not easy to describe the Mandelbrot set visually. It looks like a man, it looks like a cat, it looks like a cactus, it looks like a cockroach. It's got little bits and pieces that remind us of almost anything that you can see out in the real world, particularly living things. So it has a character that reminds us of a lot of things, and yet it itself is unique and new.
The Mandelbrot set is real, an absolute thing, no question whatsoever. Any mathematician or any computer scientist or student in a school can study it and find the same, describe the same thing. It's a common experience. And so such things that can be magnified forever and have infinite precision do exist, but they're not touchable.
It's a geometrical shape, an icon, if you wish, which somehow embodies as an example a very important aspect of how the world works. Somebody recently actually called this set the thumbprint of God.
With this mysterious image, Mandelbrot was issuing a bold challenge to long-standing ideas about the limits of mathematics.
The blinders came off, and people could see forms that were always there, but formerly were invisible.
The Mandelbrot set was a great example of what you could do in fractal geometry, just as the archetypical example of classical geometry is the circle.
When you zoom in, you see them coming up again, so you see self-similarity. You see, by zooming in, you zoom, 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 you're zooming in, and pop. Suddenly, it seems like you're exactly where you were before, but you're not. It's just that way down there, it has the same kind of structure as way up here, and the sameness can be grokked.
Now we'll begin our serious exploration of the Mandelbrot set. A voyage which, in fact, could last forever and ever, much longer than the lifetime of the universe. I have here the full set, about 6 inches across. Now, if I blow this up, I'll increase the magnification now 13 times, and you see more and more detail is appearing. And the interesting thing is you see mini Mandelbrots, replicas, almost identical, yet perhaps subtly different of the original set. And I can go on doing this. Here's a magnification of more than 3,000 times. So the original picture, about 6 inches across, is now half a mile across. And no matter how much we magnified it, a million times, a billion times, until the original set was bigger than the entire universe, we would still see new patterns, new images emerging, because the frontier, the end set, is infinitely complex. And when I say infinitely, I really mean that. Most people, when they say infinitely, they mean only rather big. But this is really infinity. is so remarkable, in fact, astounding, about the Mandelbrot set is that although it's infinitely complex, it's based on incredibly simple principles, unlike almost everything in modern mathematics. In fact, anybody who can add and multiply can understand the principles on which it's based. You don't even have to subtract or divide, still less use logarithms or trigonometrical functions to comprehend how the Mandelbrot set is created. In fact, in principle, it could have been discovered any time in human history, and not merely in 1980. But the problem is this: although it's only based on adding and multiplying, you have to carry out those operations millions, billions of times to create a complete set. And that's why it was not discovered until the era of modern computers.
All right. While this thing wraps up, if there's any questions, I want to say the Lord's Prayer real fast before we even start. The Lord's Prayer. Father, heaven, on the heaven, will be done. All right. Let's teach the Lord a prayer. Do that. So I'm going to like to do that. All right. So, you know how we do, you know how it goes. First, I gotta, get a little small intro in today, because it's been a while, So, let this thing load out, and we're gonna have a nice little conversation about some very interesting sources, some interesting things that we may have went over, but we may go over again, because why not? I think sometimes the information that is shared can be very valuable And even if it's repeated, it can be very done. All right. Been a while since I've let that play. I let this play for a certain reason. Okay. So first thing we need to talk about is a couple different things when it comes to the creation of the world. So we're just going to dive in and just talk about creation real fast. So I've been making a couple different notes. I have a couple different things I'm going to go over probably in fall, starting in fall. Things to go over a little. So I'm going to save those for another time. But we're going to talk about creation. We're actually going to talk about the roots of creation. So remember, we took hours upon hours of going over fossils and ancient lineages. We made a little map based upon Bronze Age, right? Going all the way from Bronze Age to Neolithic to Mesolithic to Paleolithic time frames. And we mapped it all out and what it would look like. And a lot of it made a lot of sense to the biblical narrative. Now, when I'm saying that, I want to first talk about something that I first wanted to conclude in its first understanding. Many people think, when they think of modern humans, they think modern humans came out of Africa. Now, that's a common saying, and a lot of people, they stand strong on that. But let's actually get real educational on this, because if you've seen, we actually got really deep in some of the videos recently of basically the out of Africa origin. Let's go to study.com and get a little understanding of something that some people overlook when they look at the out of Africa origin. There's also another concept instead of the out of Africa origin, because the out of Africa concept is actually a theory. But there's another theory that's actually getting more ground, that's actually getting more scientific ground, and is actually called the multi-regional origin, or basically a Eurasian back migration of humans. Now, you'll see it in many different places, but I have brought up multiple different papers that were very recent, right? We're talking 2020s, the 2021s, obviously they're coming out more, but 2022 papers, where they're actually doing real studies on the multi-regional origin. But let me first play this video and then get into some things real fast, because I think it's also important what it says in it. So let me just let you see something. Fair use.
What we know about human evolution continues to, well, evolve. With new fossil finds and new technologies to study these fossils, hypotheses change over time. Plus, assigning dates to migration times and fossils can prove challenging. For example, fossils can be poorly preserved, hard to find, and difficult to date. Using DNA to determine dates is difficult as well. For example, in order to use DNA to date fossils, scientists must come a mutation. How many mutations they would expect to see in the DNA over a certain time.
All right, I got to pause right here real fast. Now, what was important about what was just said? Now, one of the major things that we go over when we're dating these things, right, we're talking Mesolithic, Paleolithic, Neolithic, Bronze Age. A lot of these years are exaggerated. Right. So even this video is expressing that trying to find the ages of these individuals based upon like looking at them and just saying, well, they're in this layer, so they must be about this old, versus looking at the SNP. Right. When I say the SNP, the mutation. Right. Sometimes you'll have certain what's called haplogroups. And for those who may be familiar with them, some may not be, as I have something I'm going to talk about right before we end this, I'm going to talk about something scriptural later on. But I'm going to go to Family Tree's site real fast, because I need this tree real fast while I'm expressing what I'm saying. So we're going to first establish the foundation of the understanding when you look at biblical narrative and you're looking at the world that we're in today. A lot of people are scared of the years. They start seeing things like 50,000, 40,000, and they don't know what to do with them, right? But we know what to do with them because we look at these things very carefully and closely. Now, when you're looking at SNPs and mutations, this is what this video is going to be talking about SNPs and mutations and actually where did humans actually come from. So let me actually have this little note right here And I'm going to open one more note because we need one more note to look at real fast. And it's about, again, when we look at F-M89. Why? Because of certain connections that it has in his family. Massive connections, huge connections that are highly ignored. In fact, the F haplogroup is one of the most ignored haplogroups. F-M89 actually holds the key to knowing that there's dozens of people in the world, yet almost all of them summarize into one haplogroup. And I'm saying like the major majority of people, not every haplogroup, not every group, but that's also important too. Why not every group, right? But a major part of modern humans actually consists in this group. So I'm actually going to go to one of my notes here because we need our note on F-M89 so that we can get a little more detail on what is going to happen right here. All right. So the first important thing is what I'm saying real fast, the multi-regional origin. Now, the most important thing about the multi-regional origin is that it's talking about modern humans. It's talking about humans and talk about where they came from. And it's telling you that, no, it wasn't no group that was just in Africa solely and only came out Africa. No, there were groups actually outside of Africa. In fact, there were groups that were highly different. That's why we see even people with these ancient human admixtures in them and some without those ancient human admixtures in them, right? So I'm going to scroll right to what we're talking about real fast. We're talking about, when we're talking about the origin, we're actually talking about also a Eurasian origin. Why? Because we're connecting groups that are so-called Neanderthal and so-called Denisovans. So we'll have Denisovans in certain parts of the world, and we'll have Neanderthals in certain parts of the world. But what is interesting is the fact that modern humans are known to come from an individual named Homo erectus, which is actually a human who was in Eurasia. I'm just going to quickly read something to you, and I'm going to let the video play, and we're going to go over it, right? The results are consistent when it's going over the information of Homo erectus, just like we was talking about, in Eurasia, right? It says Eurasian, basically a division between the what is Homo sapiens, or modern humans, us, and some other ancient humans. And it's saying that they would have tied a long time ago. And the ages that they would have tied, now remember when I say the ages, based upon these ancient humans, based upon the fact that they had genetic ties with ancient humans, this shows that humans had to be connected with these ancient humans outside of Africa. Because a lot of these lineages, Denisovans and Homo erectus and different humans like that, just showing them having connection to humans means those humans had to have ties to Eurasians outside Africa. Now they go on, they talk about obviously the connection even with the Neanderthals and Denisovans. And they say also obviously on their mtDNA, this is one of the major things that they talk about when they talk about how are they connected. And they say that it's most likely by the mtDNA. That's also important to know. And that's connecting groups that even go into Africa. As it says, it talks about a Eurasian moving for the ancestors of groups like the Mbuti and the Sin. Now, if you know about the Mbuti is like a really ancient African group, or the Koshin. The Koshin is another group in Africa. So it's saying that even those oldest groups have connections. Based upon recent studies, this actually is showing that a lot of the said out of Africa concept was actually storming from eugenics. And that means that a lot of it was theory and conclusions by looking at some of the groups in Africa and concluding them being older than any group outside of Africa. But that's the thing. We're finding groups outside of Africa older than groups inside of Africa. I'll tell you why that's important. Because what it does, it establishes more the biblical narratives format versus their ancient Africa, out of Africa concept. But let's hear a little more if it lets us hear.
Is an estimate for so use DNA for dating purposes. Furthermore,
that's what it said. DNA for dating stuff, how old that person is, stuff, and they look at the layers. They actually are. Sometimes there might have been studies of individuals who were in the dirt and 1,000 years old, and they might not be. They might not be that old. So they might be from another time frame. They just don't have the right material to date them. And the layers that they're in might make someone assume that they are that old. So also remember, we had talked about this before, how water actually can make things look older. Now, a lot of people know about this and how water can make things look older. Now, I'm not going to go over it right now, but that's important to know about. If someone has a question on that, we can go deeper into that. But what I want to continue on is the concept of years by genetics or layers isn't always a sure thing. It's very, very, very important. But let's hear a little more of what's happening here, because one of the most important things is the connection of modern humans and Homo erectus. Let's hear a little bit of
from scientist to scientist. So using DNA isn't. Furthermore, some studies DNA inherited from the mother or the father, which does not always paint an accurate picture of what has taken place. As you can see, figuring out how and when Homo sapiens, the species name for modern humans, came on the world scene is challenging. Let's explore two hypotheses about human evolution, the multi-regional and the African replacement, and then discuss the evidence for each. The first, or the multi-regional hypothesis, states that Homo sapiens evolved from Homo erectus outside of Africa.
All right, so now who remember when we did a video directly on this subject? We did a video directly on this subject. If you don't remember, if you haven't seen it, let me just show it real fast. I gotta do a remake of it. Why? Because maybe to make it more smooth and all that. Obviously, you know I'm doing all these things live, but I want to show you the confidence that we can have in these things because it's true, right? And we're going over biblical subjects and connecting them with reality. So this is actually really deep. But let me show you where we actually went over the Eurasian origin for humans and why that supports the biblical narrative and what's the reason that's important. Let me just show you why that's important. First, let me go to the video. Here it is. This video I had to rewatch a few times so I can make more notes of what was happening, because all the information is critical. All the information in this video is very critical. The sources are established. I believe there's going to be individuals that are going to be wiser than me that are going to take these sources and going to establish them. As you know, we provide sources for free. Scholarly sources and deep genetic sources that are to be reused and shared. Now, this video right here is going to go here and show you why it is important. Okay, so the most important thing, what we were establishing without a doubt the origin of mankind. Where would the mankind start from? But the most credible fact about it is that it points to a Eurasian back migration. Why? Because we have dozens of sources that point to the fact that, as it says in some sources, reconstruction of outer Africa concept as not having enough proof, because the outer Africa concept is a theory. That's important. That is important. It is not found in the order of haplogroups. That means we do not see that displayed by real human genetics. That is a theory. In fact, you can look it up yourself. Out of Africa, right? If we put Africa and you get like, maybe let's put the theory, right? The out of Africa theory. So we'll have a lot of different things I'll talk about out of Africa. Let's look at this secondary source real fast from Wiki. Now watch what they basically put. So, you know, it should be common knowledge if this is true, right? If this concept is actually a true thing. But one of the most important things that almost every source that goes over this, they don't show the connection of human genetics, right? based upon modern humans. They don't show the connection of human genetics descending or only being created in Africa and coming out of Africa. That has never been displayed. I want you to know that right now. How do we know? Because look at the example of what we see right here. In this video, the video that we're just watching, it's talking about Homo erectus. Now, if you see on this design, this is what's important to know about this design. You got to look at it very carefully because actually it's telling you something. What is it telling you? It's showing you that the oldest said human, right? Because Homo erectus is actually older than Neanderthals and Homo sapiens. It'll say that Homo sapiens will be somewhere down here. But actually, humans, all humans will be considered connected by a root. So that means they would have to come from that original root. So if Homo erectus broke off of the root from humans and became his own lineage, and we know that Homo erectus had ties in Eurasia, then we would have to ask ourselves a question. Did humans start in Eurasia and work their way into Africa, or did they start in Africa, develop in Africa solely, and then come out of Africa? But this is the interesting thing. When we go back to this little video, remember, it's telling us now about Homo erectus. It's going to tell us now about Homo erectus. It is telling us that that's also a theory, because they have two theories. Remember how it says right here, the multi-regional hypothesis states that Homo sapiens evolved from Homo erectus outside of Africa. Now, if we go back to our note, we'll notice something again when we talk about Homo erectus, right? In fact, what we're going to do on here is kind of look at the spots where we actually talk about that, because there's a couple of different places where we actually highlight this human lineage. And why is that important? Because if you read the scriptures very, very well and very clear, you'll notice something interesting about it. And the most interesting thing about it is that it sounds like the scriptures are saying that humans started in Eurasia and kind of made his way throughout the whole world and filled the whole world from Eurasia. And it would seem very possible if we look at haplogroups to establish that without a doubt, like actual look at ancient haplogroups and establish where these ancient humans were. Well, we found out something really interesting. We found out Y DNA location, right? About Y DNA, for example, when they looked at basically some of the individuals that they seen, they found out something. And you know what they found out? That some of the groups that they were claiming as being African, especially like the A groups, because a lot of times they'll say these A groups, that humans come from these groups. Now, if you also notice, they're actually considered an outgroup. What is an outgroup? If we look at the root, you see the root right here? This is always going to be considered your root. That's the start of a genetic line. Now, an outgroup would be a group that separates from a node, right? So this is going to be a node, and this is going to be these are going to be clades. It's going to be a root that separates at the node, making its own clade. So they have their own clade separate from other clades. So that you're going to have outgroups that are not going to be the same as like our F-M89 lineages. So if we look at F-M89 lineages, we can see that there's a lot of lineages there. But if we go to the outgroups, scroll up a little bit right here, see these A groups right here? So these A groups will be considered outgroups. So they actually break from nodes. So they actually come from different lines. Now, what we'll see is that those will be the earliest, some of the quote unquote, based upon modern science, the earliest humans. Now, can we actually know that they're the earliest humans? We just know that they early separate from humans. That means that these humans would have the earliest effects. So it would be very important to look at them first to understand what is the origin of mankind. Well, we found out something interesting. They identified a Eurasian Y-DNA basically connecting A00 that has followed by three separate Homo sapien exoduses. So that's going to be A0, that's going to be A, that's going to be like the alpha A, or in a sense BT, the split lines. And from Eurasia into Africa with A signifying the earliest and A the most recent of these early exoduses. Now, if you know, Exodus just means a large group that leaves together into one place. So what this study is actually saying is that they are looking at the oldest humans and realizing that a lot of them are actually in Eurasia, because we had talked about how a lot of them were with Denisovans and with Homo erectus and other humans that were in Eurasia. But we see modern human haplogroups also in Eurasia making their way into the lands of Africa. So they go into Africa. They're making their way into the lands of Africa that is making a difference in those lands a little later on, right? In fact, this is what they actually say right here. So I'm going to get back to that video, but I want you to hear this first, because remember, we're looking at the multi-regional origin, and it's claiming that humans were tied with Homo erectus. And it's also claiming that they would have been Eurasian in Eurasia. A lot of recent science is saying this: the results were consistent with potentially four translocations of modern humans from Eurasia into Africa. So it's saying like four different directions of humans going from Eurasia into Africa. And it says the earliest taking place is 250,000 years before present. It says the results were in accordance with the idea of out of Eurasia. So that is actually supporting out of Eurasia hypotheses. At the same time, watch what it says, at the same time it did. At the same time as they lent no support to the out of Africa hypotheses. So they're saying that the fossils, the information that they're finding, the fossils, all the information that they're actually finding, you know what is verifying? That where did this out of Africa concept come from? In fact, why would humans only be in Africa when, remember, the world used to be a supercontinent a long time ago? This was interesting about the world. We know that the world had continents moving around, right? The continents were moving around. And humans had to supposedly come from one of those creatures, supposedly. But what's the most interesting thing about all of creation? The interesting thing is we know that before humans were here, the world was a supercontinent. And then it divided. So what made Africa more different in any environment that would have sprung of humans versus any other environment? What made Africa different, right? What made it actually different? And it actually, if you study ancient Africa wasn't that inhabitable. There were parts of Africa that was frozen. There was parts of Africa that had dried up. There was parts of Africa that were destroyed. But there are a lot of areas that were very, very rich in the Fertile Crescent, right? When we think about the Fertile Crescent. And it's almost like when you look at the biblical narrative, it's talking a lot about cultures starting in the Fertile Crescent. In fact, it's interesting when you think about the earliest cultures of men. You'll start noticing where they would start. But here's a little bit of that study right there. It's really interesting. So let's before we get there, let's get back to that video. Because that video actually is going deep into what we want to talk about. As you see, multi-regional hypotheses states that Homo sapiens supposedly evolved from Homo erectus outside of Africa. So if that concept was true and there were sources supporting that idea, we might find genetic ties that would tie humans to Eurasians. And if we was to find genetic ties of humans to Eurasians, what would that mean that the out of Africa concept, where should we put the out of Africa concept? Where should we put it? We should throw it away. We should throw it away and note where it came from. There's a lot of studies for where the out of Africa concept, where did it actually come from? What mind frame got people to think that people who are of a darker race are less evolved than another people? Think about that. Just think about that. Does that sound like a science? Does that actually sound like an actual science to you? That a people with a different color, maybe a different facial feature, might be less evolved than someone of a different color and maybe a different facial feature? Does that actually make a different race? Or are they still modern humans?
is almost every human today modern humans? So we should probably expect to look at these things maybe in the blood versus the pigmentation. But there was a deception going on where a lot of these things came from, right? You'll think about things like the Enlightenment, right? Where a lot of different groups would come together and have different ideas. Now, there's a lot to go into that, but let's kind of understand the truth real fast. Multi-regional is actually sensible. Now let's talk about it real fast scripturally. Would it make sense for a multi-regional origin for Adam and his descendants? If Adam was kicked out of the land, let's just open up a map. Let's go to a map and take a look real fast at something. And I want to open your mind to the biblical narrative and really what it's saying, what the biblical narrative is actually saying to you, right? So when God began to create the earth, and he talks of things of the earth, and then all of a sudden, all the water settles. He makes his creatures. He makes the birds. He makes all the different things. Where did he make man from? Does he make man from nothing? No, he takes man from the dirt. So we got to note that? Because animals were eating dirt. Fish were eating dirt. Almost every creature was eating dirt. Whether they was eating the plants that grew out of it, right? They was eating the earth. And man was taken from the earth. What does that mean if man was taken from the earth? Genetically, do you know what that means for man? That means genetically, man should be tied with every creature in the world. Because it would look like man will be taken from every creature in the world. You know that makes scientific sense? That if we look at man, it's the last of creation. Do you know that that makes scientific sense? That humans are the last of creation and that they show that they would come from all creation, that they look like they have ties to every single piece of creation. Think about that. Wouldn't that make more sense for the biblical narrative to be telling us that man is the last of creation and he has ties to every piece of creation because he is taken from the earth, right? From earth you are to earth you return. So it's important to understand man isn't just made from like some different material. Man is made from the same thing that every single thing on the earth was blessed to have, the earth. So we have to understand that man starts and God puts them in a secret place. Where is Eden? Wherever you may say Eden is, say it is, that's whatever you wear. What does that mean? They lived somewhere around here and they lived there. But what happened? They were kicked out. So Adam and Eve was kicked out of Eden. So where did they die? Where did Adam and Eve die? What about Cain? Where did he die? Where did Cain, Abel, and all the rest of them die? Because those groups want to start spreading and increasing in the world. What's interesting about the concept of the scriptures, we know that just from Adam, Cain, and his lines, let's say if Adam was kicked out and he went over here, let's say he settled over here. And let's say Cain was kicked out and he settled somewhere over here. His massive. And let's say Adam's family grew massive. And let's say he had other sons and daughters and they settled. And their families grew massive. We started to settle. Maybe they settled over here, going over here, filling the whole earth, right? So let's say that. Let's say they filled, and then a chaotic disaster happened. Evidences of a chaotic disaster ever happening. A lot of evidences, especially when we talk about the Neolithic bottleneck. Right. The Neolithic bottleneck is one of the most important evidences of how the world actually became what it is today. Right. So let's first understand this at its peak. If I had to tell you that Adam and Eve left that they were at and Adam and Eve settled somewhere and had kids, they had Seth and they had more kids. Remember, there was a massive amount of people before Noah. Before Noah even was there, we would have had all types of different families settled in all types of different areas. So that's very important. And if they settled in the areas of Earth, then they would be one blood. They'd be seen genetically tied by the root. So that would make sense when we note those things. Yet that blood would have interesting connections to many different people, right? But one of the most important things, I think, is understanding that they could have settled anywhere. They could have settled in Africa. They could have settled in Eurasia. They could have settled in the lands of anywhere. But what would have happened? They would have been in multiple regions. Because remember, Cain went to one place. Seth went to one place, right? Adam went to one place. A lot of these individuals settled in different places. So the origin of humans described by this biblical narrative sounds more like a multi-regional origin. And it makes sense when you look at the whole entirety of the thing. But let's look a little more at it. So this is what actually, when you look at human evolution or human creation, this is a subject that is usually ignored, but lots of information actually supports this concept that the biblical narrative makes more sense to the creation, to the understanding of creation and the progress of creation, right, after creation, versus what a lot of people are guessing with their theories, like obviously that Africa concept.
Thence for each. The first, or the multi-regional hypothesis, states that Homo sapiens evolved from Homo erectus outside of Africa. This hypothesis suggests that Homo erectus slowly wandered out of Africa and inhabited other regions. Homo erectus looked somewhat human-like, having long legs and shorter arms. Like humans, it walked on two legs and was larger and smarter than the earlier Homo species. After leaving Africa, the populations of Homo erectus did not become completely
All right, I just want to give you that little highlight. So this is the things that we were going over before. So this video right here, I'll put in the description, is Out of Eurasia, Eugenic Out of Africa Debunked. So if you had seen this, you would have seen the breakdown of why we do not, right? Why we do not accept the Out of Africa concept, because it actually is racist by its roots. And a few people actually know that. It's a very prejudiced concept that came up that has almost no support. And only people that support it is people who kind of have a blind eye. They don't look at like all the totality of the fossils and different things that are actually found, but they just look at just what they've been taught, just what they've been taught and what they can find, not what can be found. So it's very, very important. That's why a lot of people talk about these things, a lot of different individuals talk about these things. Let me just give you one more highlight real fast from this little right here. Out of Africa theory contradicted by Israeli fossil. So obviously they have found some fossils in the lands of Israel. This was very important, right? So Jeffrey P. Tompkins got a PhD, and he actually is going over the evidence of how many people who think about the Out of Africa concept, they are relying that no humans, right? No humans, especially modern humans, existed outside of Africa. But as we find more humans outside of Africa, and some of them even before humanoids in Africa, it makes the quote unquote idea of evolution almost laughable when you say that there were modern humans only in Africa, because we start seeing them in different areas. So this is a little interesting one. This is a little interesting read that goes over some of the finds that they found, especially the ones that they find in the areas of Eurasia. And it talks about why that makes no sense. But they also go over how a lot of this information makes more sense when you connect it with the biblical narrative. In fact, it says, from a biblical and creation science perspective, it is believed, right? When you talk about the different specimens and all that, it's basically saying a lot of these different specimens will represent basically humans that would be like post-flood individuals that would be living shortly after the dispersal up from the Tower of Babel about 4,000 years ago. Now, a lot of people, when they look at these years, they got to be careful on those, on the layers, on the layers of these things. We can do that separate. We can talk about that separate on why you got to be careful on those layers. But one, again, as we can see, a lot of different understandings as they talk about the remains of Homo erectus. And it talks about how he was in different areas of the Asian islands and eastern parts of Europe. But they talk about basically if humans have connections to these groups, as a lot of science is actually showing, then it means that the guesswork that people were previously doing has to be put on blast. It has to be put on blast. It has to be put out that the out of Africa concept, not only is it being debunked, but as it says, the out of Africa theory, as they say, is the most widely accepted explanation for the origins of modern humans. Now, does widely accepted mean true? No, because as the findings show, the theory is not going to last. As more of the findings start to build up, the theory is not going to last anymore, because the Eurasian multi-regional theory makes biblical sense, and it makes more sense logically, because why would we think that humans, especially modern humans, would only be contained, one of the, being the most smartest of all of them, to come out only in the lands that are just one island, right? One big continent. When rather, we know that early humans were sailing. They were selling boats. They were moving around early on. So these humans that were smarter and more agile, more able to do a lot of different things, they could have easily started off and spread throughout the world quickly, more quicker than any other species. So a lot of these things make sense for that concept. A lot of these things make sense for that concept. So I just want to say that real fast. When we talk about the biblical narrative, the first thing we got to establish is origins. Our human origins, human creation origins, is not that they only started in Africa. Look at that. That's only 200,000. We just talked about stuff from 250,000 and up. So if they say that humans only started here, even if they say that there was a human that was found over here and they said it was 300,000, but we also got information that humans were connected to other individuals that was supposedly 400,000 in Eurasia. So there's that, it's always that they want to step a little higher in Africa, but then they find out that something has been found in Eurasia way older than that. So it makes them look, it makes them have to reconstruct and redesign their outer Africa theory, their concept. And it's always being reconstructed. It's always being redesigned. It's always being changed. So sometimes they try to say humans started over here. They couldn't find any evidence for humans starting over here. Then they found humans over here. Then they try to connect the humans over here. These are real things that if someone, you know, scholarly, especially someone who knows about genetics, if they ever talk about these things or go over these things, that's what they will go over. They'll point to the oldest human starting around here now. But they know that that human, again, might not even be modern human, because they try to connect what looks like a Neanderthal to humans. And that concept can still be used in the same of Homo erectus. So if you understand what I'm saying, when I'm saying that, there's no doubt that humans are not isolated species that just popped up in these lands. They're not an isolated species. But rather, you know what humans are? They're a mixture. They're a mixture of all types of different combinations that God had put forth. But the modern human, that's the human of the biblical narrative, the modern human. So the modern human is actually the human of the biblical narrative. That's very important. And God is the one that actually is performing what he's performing. Now, there's a lot of symbolism and a lot of things to know when he's talking what he's talking. But the most important thing is observable science, observable information is verifying what looks to many people to be an establishable understanding of human origins, for human creation, for the understanding of these things. It's just that people can't be afraid of some of the years and things like that. Those are things that we go over separate in different ways, many, many different ways. Let me go back over here. Now, I also want to, the reason why I want to do this, because this is just a start. This is just, today is just a start. We're going to get back to getting some lives and some information. We're going to keep having these holy conversations live because it's important. But an individual wanted to have a conversation about who we believe to is the Jews. But before I even started that, it's been a while since I established origins. So I wanted to come live and establish those origins real fast on humankind, right? So whether someone says they believe in science or whether someone says, I don't want to listen to the science, I want to hear what the biblical narrative is saying, I'm telling you that both those things can be put together in harmony. Like there's a total agreement with these things when you realize that one of these years are exaggerated. One of these years are symbolic. And a lot of times, even science is telling you that the recent conclusions, right? A lot of recent conclusions that you can calculate years, the way that people try to quote unquote calculate years, were not real ways of calculating years. So that's what we just went over today. We went over a couple of different orders. Some of those are frozen. All right. So now with those things understood too, now you see how I'm showing you that there could be a multi-regional origin for humans. Now, also, we know that when we think about the biblical narrative, and for the individual that may want to have a conversation about who are the Jews, as that most likely will be happening soon when we have that conversation on who are the Jews, because those are always the most interesting conversations. Let me first point out something that I think is very interesting, and a brother has shown me recently, and a scripture I must have overlooked or didn't fully understand a long time ago or whatever it was, but it stood out to me when he pointed it out to me. So let me actually read this scripture right here, as I think this is extremely deep and important. All right. Few people probably seen this one or remember this scripture right here. This will be very, very important and deep. I'm going to actually read it right here from the KJV. I don't mind the translation, but I'm just going to use this one because I think it is a nice sounding one. All right. So watch what it says here of the individual that is actually of Judah. Now, what we have to first note here is that on 1 Chronicles 2, we're actually going to get some of the sons of Israel. Right, now, what's interesting about this saying? Let me show you. It talks about the sons of Judah. It tells us a couple of different sons of Judah, and it tells us all Judah has basically five sons, and obviously his sons had sons, and their sons had sons, and the sons of sons and sons of sons, right? And we know that that's where David came from. We know that's the line that David came from and whatnot. And we know that other ones had other individuals that were tied with this individual, right? You can see when we scroll down, this is what we want to look at right here. So let's just talk about Judah. So you can see he's still going on and his children, his cities and different ones and everything. But it starts to talk about an individual that I think is very interesting to talk about. Sorry if I say his name weird. Sheshan. Now, Sheshan had no sons. Now, this is when it gets really interesting. Apparently he had no sons, but daughters. He had some daughters. And it says, Sheshan had a servant, an Egyptian. So we got to note that Sheshan's servant is an Egyptian. And his name was Jarha. Now, obviously, this Egyptian is going to be a servant of a man of Judah. But notice that he had daughters, that man of Judah. And it says, Sheshan gave his daughter to Jarsha, his servant, to wife, and she bare him, sorry I said that wrong, Atte. So this, that word got me right there. Atte. And Atte had Nathan, and Nathan begat Nabad. And you can see his family goes on, and he had his sons for many generations. Now, this was interesting. This is really interesting. Why? Real quick, within the genealogies of Judah, it decides to tell us that some of the the generations of Judah had tied in with the men of Egyptians. Now, this is not shocking because we know that the Israelites had left with the Egyptians, with some. We also seen in some of the laws where it said in third generation, some will be bound together. But this is actually really interesting. Why? Because in this illustration, what we're seeing is that Israel will be obviously a tribe of individuals, but they also would have Egyptians amongst their mix, majorly. And this actually is important to know because when we think about these Israelites, right? When we think about these Israelites, and we want to understand how they are moving about and how they are growing and what their genetic groups would look like. We have to consider the scriptures, that the scriptures are telling us that a group that would be Egyptians, so whatever group you look at, study, find the Egyptians that would have been about in the time of the Israelites. Those Egyptians could have easily had ties with the Israelites. Now, what does that mean for the Israelites? That means sometimes if you study them, they might look like Egyptians because they would have interbreeding with Egyptians. This is important because when we start looking at what Egyptians look like, we start noticing what the Israelites look like. So we start to find something in this world that if we look at it with a true scope, we can find real evidence of reality. But sometimes people don't like what they see. Sometimes people don't like what they find. Sometimes they might find something that might make their worldview or their view altered. And they might not like that. So let's say, like, for example, this may lead someone down a dark view. Let's say they was looking for light and they found darkness. They were trying to find something and they found obscurity. And it was not what they thought it was leading to. To them, their light was their answer. They wanted it to go ding, ding, ding. It's exactly what I thought it was. But sometimes it may go a route where you might look at it and be like, I got to take a second and think about this, maybe pray about it or study it more. And one of the biggest things that I found that has shocked many people is three things. Let me say those three things. The three things is this. One, that Israelites are mixed, that Israelites have a mix in them. Not that they're all mixed and not that they're unfindable. And I don't mean mixed as in they're mutt, that you'll never be able to find out what they are, but they have intertwined themselves with the nations. And the scripture also says that some of the mixing was also, in a sense, done and recorded, as in it was a massive mix, as an early massive mix that made a massive family amongst them. So a lot of those mixes are important. So that's one. Israelites are actually mixed. Two, this is actually another one that's actually very important, but is usually ignored. Israelites are highly dark skinned. Now, whoever doesn't like that, you have to look at ancient Israelites during the time when they was in the Iron Age. A lot of them were highly dark skinned. Now, not all of them. I'm not saying all of them were dark skinned, but I'm sure there were some mixed ones, some light ones. But Israelites overall look like Nubians. They look just like Nubians and Egyptians during that time. And Egyptians started getting darker and darker and darker over time. We know because I got a source. If someone says no, I can bring the source out and show you that Egyptians genetically were getting darker. That's just a fact. Because they were mixing with Nubians more. And also the Israelites were mixed with Nubian. We know this because of the facts of just looking at the ancient finds in the lands of Avaris. When the Israelites were in Egypt, even the Bible tells us Joseph got with an Egyptian and Moses got with a Cushite. So we got a lot of examples. We got Judah getting with a Canaanite, and we got all types of different examples of individuals that would intermix during that time. Now that's actually interesting and important for Israel. That's interesting and important for Israel because as that cultures would develop, as we see different places when they say, aren't you like the Ethiopians to me and different things like that. And some writers, especially in the first century, saying the Jews look like Ethiopians, look like a race of Ethiopians. sometimes you'll get a very important conclusion that the Israelites don't just look like Ethiopians, they don't just look like Nubians, but they also look like Egyptians. Now, this is actually important because they are Southern Levantine. So they're going to be Southern Levantine groups with a very, very interesting intermixing. Now, remember, they had Amorites amongst them, but they didn't mix with them. That's important. A lot of them didn't mix with them. They started to mix with a lot of groups later on. But major groups that they mixed with was especially the Egyptians that they left out with. And as they got in certain lands, they would have a separation with certain groups. So they would have a lot of separation with certain groups in those lands. But certain ones mix. And we can find those groups very clearly when we look at the genetic results. So with that said, that's going to always be a controversial thing, that the Jews, early Jews and early Israelites, were African-like, very African-like. That's just what we find, that early Israelites, especially by a lot of different stones, a lot of different designs of them, they look African-like. So those are first the two things, right? And a third. This third one is also a reason why we have a lot of conversations on these things. And that's haplogroup. A lot of people, they want to know the exact haplogroup. So three things, right? Three things. And the reason why this is important to know, that one, the Israelites are mixed. Two, they're also dark-skinned. So you can be mixed and dark-skinned. You can be mixed and dark-skinned. And you can also have one haplogroup. Now, that's the biggest thing. What haplogroup is the Israelites? Because once you find their haplogroup, you can find the Moabites, the Edomites, all the different groups that are their cousins and relatives, because they're related. They'll be blood related. That's what's the most important thing about finding the Israelites directly. And that's why we did many different studies on the Israelites, pointing out where they came from and where they were, and showing that if we was to find them genetically, we can connect their family. And that's some very interesting and important stuff. So I'll just leave it like that for now. For now, I just want to basically establish this before we come back and hopefully have this conversation on some things that we usually talk about, like who are the people. Look at the origin of humans. The biblical narrative actually screams out to us. It screams out. It screams out that there is a multi-regional origin of humans, that humans were settled in pretty much every part of the world. As scripture said, they filled the whole earth. And by the time that there was a Neolithic bottleneck or a complete wipeout in a bottleneck, a group that rose up, small group of individuals that rose up, they also start to repopulate the earth. After they repopulate the earth, then we'll get close to the biblical narrative, where you'll have obviously the Tower of Babel and all the events of that, and then working his way down into Abraham. So by the time of Abraham, you'll have a complexity of nations around, but from Abraham and his seed comes the promise. So that's what's very important of these things. Very, very important. So I'll leave it like this. Be careful on the out of Africa theory, because one, the biggest reason why a lot of people actually approach people in challenging against like bringing information is because they have a set notion. They have a set notion. And sometimes it might be from bad roots, very bad roots. So the out of Africa concept is usually why most people come up and say, no, the Israelites are not black. They can't be dark skinned at all. Or they can't be a haplogroup that we think is African, or some stuff like they can't be mixed or some stuff like that. There's certain things that come up, certain doctrines that come up that are dangerous, but they always have a root. You find the root and you'll find out what's going on in that doctrine. So that's going to be the key in pointing out where the thought of the argument is coming from. What's the reason why one wouldn't want something to be something? Versus, I have a source, look at this instead and consider this. Because sometimes you can have a source with information, but someone don't want to see it because it's not supporting their theory. It's not supporting what they want. So that's one of the biggest things. The out of Africa concept is eugenics. And it's actually very, very, very bad. Not good. So I'll put something in the description for that. So with that, if any questions, let me know. But if you ask me on the human origin of all humans, is a Eurasian origin. If you ask me for the origin of all humans, it all has started in Eurasia. I already proved it too by the biblical narrative that it would make no sense for any of the humans to start in Africa only. Even when we think about where did Cain get cursed, right? He was not in Africa when he got cursed, right? These are concepts when we think about the biblical narrative that a lot of times they'll claim that a lot of the groups in Africa are Hamites only, but the complexity to the picture is the life is in the blood. So the life is in the blood. We had to look at things by the blood. So if someone ever comes and talks skin doctrine, it's not going to work. It's not going to work. We talk blood doctrine. We talk blood doctrine. So we'll establish the haplogroups and establish the genetic lines and establish the autosomal mixes and establish the fact of where humans will come from because we looked at the roots. So that's what the most important thing. So now that we got the roots done real fast, again, we're going to get on some different things another time as time goes because this little thing's not loading. I don't need that anyways. All right. So that was the truth about the origin of humans. There is a Eurasian origin for almost every human. And I'm talking even African humans. They have a Eurasian origin, a Eurasian back migration. So they are in Africa now. There's a lot of groups that are in Africa now, but they weren't always in Africa. Now, there are some groups that are older in Africa versus other groups, and those can be established. But if you ask about where the humans actually come from, where they start and where they go, they start in Eurasia and they went down into the areas of Africa. So Fertile Crescent is actually a homeland of humans. So it's very, very important. So Fertile Crescent. So pretty much all the Fertile Crescent. So with that, family, that's all I got for now. May you be blessed. May you be beloved. And